Hi. 16 years ago, I was working as a fashion designer, and I was in a plane flying to Asia with a company I worked for, a well-known fashion brand, and I was sitting in the plane next to my boss and the product manager of the brand. We were flying to Asia, of course, for production to meet a Chinese boss of a lot of factories that made our stuff. My boss was calculating, and at a certain moment, he said to the product manager, "Listen, if we meet this Chinese guy, we have to try to get 2% more profit margin, because I've been calculating. If we get that with the sales of this year, combining, I can buy a Bentley next year." And he was not joking. This guy already had a BMW and a Porsche Cabriolet and I don't know what. And that was the moment it hit me. I was sitting there as a designer trying to design good stuff and applying my designs to the brand's identity. And it hit me, suddenly, these guys who make the decisions are in it solemnly for the money. They want to make money as much and as fast as they can. And that was the moment I so strongly felt, I have to get out of here. I don't want to be part of this business anymore. Oh.
What is wrong to make money?
There's nothing wrong with making money, but if that's your only goal, I think a lot of good things get lost. Quality, good design, improving products, having time to improve. So I'll get back to that. I hope you understand after my speech what I mean. In the 90s, the fast fashion industry entered, and consuming of fabrics went faster and faster and of fashion. Now I'm an artist. I only work with textile waste. I love textiles. I think we all love textiles. It's the material so near to us, we forget it's there. Try to feel for a moment what you're wearing. You forget you have it on. It's with us. We allow it to be with us all day. It carries our emotions, our blood, sweat, and tears, like you see here. It's warm and functional and caring and helps us. It's tangible. Textiles invite you to touch. You get curious. You want to feel all these materials, these fantastic textiles. Every piece of textile that's made is full of development, of knowledge, of craftsmanship, of centuries and centuries of hands making and creating and now machines. It's a material that absorbs color and radiates color in fantastic ways, in all its shades, and it ages and behaves in a way like we do. And I love fashion. I think fashion is a feast of creativity, of imagination. It allows you to show to the world who you are, who you want to be. It's fantastic. And clothes show where you belong to, what's your cultural identity. This was our daughter in Mexico, by the way, a long time ago. But there's a downside to this. When I cycle through Amsterdam, I see this every day when I go to my studio. But I've also seen this in New York, in Vienna, in Mexico, in Brazil. Everywhere I go, people discard textiles and clothes. There are recycling systems, a very good one in the Netherlands, actually. But if you put your things in there, you have the feeling you give it away, you donate. And part of it is given to charity, to the Red Cross for disasters and so on. And the part of it that's not usable anymore will be recycled in a good way, shredded and becomes cleaning cloths for the industry, or it becomes insulation for houses, very practical. But the majority of what we donate in these recycle bins is sold to the African markets. And now, African countries have let us know they no longer want our second-hand clothes. And why is that? Because it's totally destroying their local economies. It's messing up with their traditional dress ways and also the development of contemporary fashion that Sunny yesterday explained about. Textile is the second most polluting industry in the world. It's right behind oil. And that's because of dyeing, of water use, treatments, chemicals. And we all know pictures like this. After the disaster in Rana Plaza, some small steps have been made to improve labor conditions, but these are very small steps. Most of our clothes are made in this way, I just showed you, and that's because we got used to this. This is the result of the fast fashion system that we're in since the 90s. And I'm not blaming and shaming H&M, mind you, because many, many, many brands work in this way. And it's us being tempted to buy a lot more and more. Because we got used to prices like this. If you see a shirt like this for this price, you know that somewhere along the line things went terribly wrong. This is simply not possible. But it's there, everywhere around us. People got exploited, the environment was not taken in consideration. And that's because this is how this system works. Made for this amount, sold for this amount. And not only in the cheap fashion, also in the more upmarket brands. Oh, I missed one, like you see here. This is a chart that shows how the consumption of textiles of fashion has increased. Look at the 60s. On the left side, you see the percentage of the income spent on clothing. So now, where we are now, we buy a lot more for a lot less percentage of our income. When I was young, a teenager in the 80s, we were somewhere in the middle. And now, we're even further up there than you see in 2010. This is scary. And at the bottom, you see what happened with production. There, it's still produced locally most, and now it's outsourced overseas. There are, of course, brands who do it a lot better. This is very well known. And also on a haute couture level, there are people that really try to make statements about doing it in a better way. And they're doing fantastic jobs. But still, fashion is really a throwaway product. And that's what you see here. This is the result in such a recycling hall where all of this donated stuff is stocked. So knowing all this, and after my epiphany in the plane, I had to really rethink how I was treating textiles. I was trained as a fashion designer because I loved going to art school and being with my hands and materials and working with textiles. But knowing this downside, I had to come up with a new way. And the problem is so big, and it touches our economic system, maybe even capitalism, greed and need, I don't know what. And it was confusing. But then I started to start in my own little surroundings with what I have. So I started with a crate I found in the street, some leftovers of textiles I had, and made something like this. And then something happened. This is me as a five-year-old. I always have loved to make things bigger than myself. There I'm making a giant real-size Santa. So I thought, let's try this bigger than myself. Here my daughter is helping me. At home, do try this at home, I thought. And then I realized, oh, if I want to do this on a bigger scale, I have to start collecting more and more textile waste. And this was absolutely no problem, just from the people around me in Amsterdam. This is how my studio looks now, and this is not even all I have. It resulted in pieces like this, that I also make on commission for certain sites, certain spaces. This is a conference room of a lawyer's firm. And when I work on commission, I can use the textiles from the client too. I ask them, give me your leftover, discarded, unwanted clothes. And then a funny thing happens. They give me pieces from their children, from people that passed away, and I put it in. And they start telling me stories that are so connected to those clothes, to those textiles. Because I rely totally on what's donated, what's given to me, it has changed my design process completely. As a fashion designer, I made drawings, send it overseas, and there the materials would be sourced by the factory, and then it would come back. Now, I have to design with what I get, what's here. So I make giant, big, black pieces, as you see here. And something funny happens then with the status of brands. I get weird donations, like lace from the Amsterdam Museum, for example. And I washed it, I hang it, I dipped it in black, I made pieces, dipped it in black. And then I made an installation like this. It was my comment on news about racial oppression and more discrimination going on in the world. Really made me sad. So I wanted to show it's the exact same material, the only difference is the color. If I dye my fabrics, I do it in an organic way, and I'd only do it partly. So you will always see the state of the textile, how it came to me. Sometimes it's new, sometimes it's used, sometimes it's torn and worn. And then you get pieces like this. Nature is a thing I look at a lot because of the organic patterns, helps me select colors. And I really love making things that have a certain natural organic irregularity from waste that's actually threatening nature. I look at old crafts, very rudimentary, simple crafts that have been there for ages, like this Navajo loom. It's really fantastic, simple, but so functional. And I have to adjust them. I have to hack these techniques because I work with the textiles made by machines and I try to weave them into a simple craft way. If I have a loom, I can make more pieces, of course, all in the same size. And here you see how it looks up close. I get weird stuff, sometimes fishnets, for example, torn pieces of fishnets, and then I have to do it with that. I get discarded yarns from a carpet factory. That results in pieces like this, and you still see the shape of the fishnet in this rug. On my label that I put on everything, I really try to emphasize on that this piece may age, like you. And that if you're sick of it, you have to throw it in this recycle bin so it can be shredded to something functional. Or that you bring it back to me so I can have it adjusted if you move or want to have it repaired in a way. This is a project I did as an artist in residence here in Amsterdam in a shared workspace. I organized a fashion swap, asking the people of this particular building to donate their unwanted fashion items and collected them. We had a swap, people used things again, but there was a lot of leftovers. We cut them up, we created long strips, lots of strips, and then I had a workshop teaching these people a simple craft how to make robes. And they loved it because they're behind computers all day, like most of us. And this resulted in a self-made room divider in their shared workspace coming from their own waste. And they were very proud of the robes they made. Yesterday here, we had a fashion swap too. Some of you were there and some of you brought me your leftover unwanted misfits, all the impulse buys we all do. And I'm not better than all of you because if I enter a Zara store, I end up buying something. But now what's being thrown in here is actually your waste. Eh? The meaning was a swap. So you bring something, you pick something and take it home. But what happens always is I get more than people take with them. We all want to get rid of it. It's too much. Our closets are full. So that's what I work with. These three works sort of sum up my story, because we're heating up the planet by our consumer behavior. It's a dirty business, but I try to make something beautiful and magical with it, confronting people with their waste. And I encourage you and I invite you to rethink your own use of textiles. And I invite you as designers or creative thinkers to help me in a way, because I know, I'm very aware that what I make with my own two hands saves only a drop in an ocean of textile waste. This problem is immense, tremendous, so big. So it's a call to you, actually, to rethink this. Thank you. Everybody, let's recycle.